during that period, and once the two companies, the Canterbury Aero Company and the New Zealand Aero Transport Company, went out of business about 1923 while they were using these aeroplanes. The aeroplanes went to the New Zealand Permanent Air Force, and the Permanent Air Force actually became the Aero Transport Company of New Zealand.
So this is another
It was quite eerie to me, Jerry, last year. The aeroplane watch site, which was one of the close base for the New Zealand Aero Transport Company, it's only about a kilometre away from my place. They have a building that's called a fertilizer, and you can go into that building and actually stand under the roof of the original 1919 hangar. And it was quite an eerie experience for me. The famous pilots who have actually been through that hangar and spoken underneath it, you could almost hear the ghostly voices.
As you can see from the ground crew, the Avro 504 didn't have any brakes, so on the ground you will need one.
Just takes off, classical Lockheed, followed by the Boeing 7.
Here today, quite a number of radials. The cylinders are arranged in a circle. Sometimes there's one row, sometimes there are two rows, depending on the horsepower of the motor. And you can see the stem coming in a very nice crosswind landing. In fact, I think it might be a very nice slow pass cranked into it. I'm by Rex Dovey today. Rex has been here before. I know that Rex is 12 junior.
And the wind blows.
ladies and gentlemen. And he's lining up against the Kiwi. Kiwi's going to take on a Russian. Bit of history going down here. Icky Tullock, you've probably heard of Icky Tullock. Check this out. This is super. To your right, look down there. Here goes your Hercules, just about to get airborne. Is based up in Auckland, part of number 5 squadron. Okay, here's its first high speed pass. It's about 100 feet, 700 kilometres an hour, and just feel the noise that goes past. The aircraft today is being flown by Simulator David Blackwood-Smith. And also make sure that they found this Wanaka. They've got the navigator on board, while it's marked Whiteside. The flight engineer is being master engineer Grant Goodwin and Richard Gillies. As well as probably aware down the back of the aircraft, there's all the electronic equipment that's operated by the air and flight operators. Now back today, we've got Corporal Michael Kennedy performing that ride. The aircraft's now breaking into the circuit, and it's pulled its power off and using the immense drag to slow down to about 145 knots or 270 kilometres an hour. It's going to be turning back towards us. As it approaches, the pilot's going to lower the gear and he's going to open the bomb bay doors. It's a good opportunity to get a look underneath the aircraft, all the flap extended, the bomb bay doors open and the landing gear down. The Orions, if you're wondering, and into facts and figures, we pitched some way back in 1966. And we pitched another one for the Australians in 1983. So, we've been at service with us. Let's see, what's that doing? Quick bit of maths. Well, over 30 years. Okay, let's get inside the bomb bay door there. And if
if you're stranded inside the bomb bay, they can hold four torpedoes or eight 500-pound bombs or 4,000-pound bombs, or on more commonly, their search and rescue configuration, responsible for looking after is some 25 million square kilometres, slightly bigger than the average Kiwi quarter acre. Okay, it's now positioning for a low pass just in front of us. Good opportunity to see the Orion up close, and then after that, the captain's just going to put it into an overshoot. If there's any large metal objects below them, you can survive and see if they are out of water. I'm sure if you made it sake and you were sitting there in your life raft and being there for a few hours or days, or maybe, to see a sight like that coming overhead would be very welcome indeed, and I'm sure there'd be much hollow meters and out. And it has all three stages of flap extended. Can get into airfields as short as Napier, Timaru, Woodburn, etc. And probably be able to land and take off here, but wouldn't be able to carry much fuel. So here it is coming in for a low approach and overshoot. Checkers are getting airborne to go and position themselves before they commence the aerobatic routine. Day and night with the aid of night vision goggles and utilize the quiet range conditions. Original designation, Hu-1 helicopter utility-1. slightly, and then it dips down, and what looks like a bit like a bow in the river. Recognition of Bruce Fulham's efforts. It was in 2002, it was named the World Helicopter Squadron of the Year, which is a very prestigious award. And it was also the same year that Three Squadron became the only unit outside Australia to get the Australian Defence Force Award. During the recent Battle 2 flooding, rescuing many people that were trapped on the roofs of their houses. Also, worked extensively when we have our big snowfalls. With the farms we have on the in Canberra that have been snowfall a number of years ago, trying to rescue stock and also deliver pay out to any stranded sheep and cattle. And just like there on, there's a crew on 2 hours' notice, 24 hours a day, 365 days in a year, to be utilised whether it be counter-terrorism or search and rescue. Service with us since the mid-1960s. Currently a program underway, and they're looking at replacing them in the next year or two. It's been a wonderful helicopter for the Royal New Zealand Air Force, and served us really, really excellently. Shooting an aircraft coming in, you want to stay as high as possible to the last possible minute. Now, or 100 knots over the fence, although the polys, no flaps, fun aircraft. If you get a chance to have a look at one, folks, they're a combination of aluminium, wood, fabric, tough, nuggety little monoplane fighter.
Anything else in there? A bit of tea, some biscuits?
Oh, you could have allowed them one.
Here she comes.
John Lamont brings in the Lavochkin La-9. And just, it's an indication of how capable Russian aeronautical engineering is. Something like 10 or 12 years separates the design of this aircraft with the Polis that we saw earlier on. Look at the development. Look at the development.
It's one of the fastest fighters to come out of the war, this thing. You can see why.
Engaging the aircraft, if they saw one of these, we can have it to turn around and get away as fast as they could.
pretty serious rate of crime near it, folks. This is a little bit of Jurgis back in the 1930s, really, isn't it? Down the way. And here we are, the yellow line landing to your right, folks. Get that camera going.
Well done, John. Good job.
Working that rudder. Good job.
Yeah.
talking with Jack Stafford. He flew Hurricanes in World War II, and then Tempests in the 486 squadron. Short journey with Jack Stafford, while the Hurricane prepares for its display. And here she comes, the 153. Before that, he flew Hurricanes. Jack, a couple of comments about the characteristics of the aircraft that fly.
It had no crisis. It turned beautifully. And then you drive home.
Thank you. blame me for that one.
So those two aircraft beetling away over there. Here's a Mustang. An aircraft that changed the war, the Second World War.
Thank you.
stores that it could use. So not known for its ground attack role in T-28.
Flown today by Rob Sillich, who's an ex-New Zealand aerobatics champion. Rob's a co-owner of this aircraft.
Something.
Radio. much different capability in those aircraft, spanning, like I said, the 5 hours on the outside now. And the picture 1941 is obviously in the 1960s and 70s.
You're welcome,
bro.
and gentlemen, so far today we've seen a number of aircraft fly that make up the Breitling Fighters. This team was put together by Ray Hanna and under the sponsorship flying under the Breitling name for 5 seasons in Europe. It's displayed to over 25 million people in 13 different countries in Europe and has performed at all the major European air shows. Along the way, they've accumulated several awards, including winning the trophy for the best display team at the 1999 and the 2003 Biggin Hill Air Fairs, in front of over 250,000 spectators there. They even edged out the world-famous Red Arrows. Now, this is a team that was put together flying 4 quite disparate aeroplanes. We've got the Kiwi Corsair, we've got the P-40 Kittyhawk, Spitfire Mk. 60 different flight characteristics. So when you see the team perform, especially in the foreship aerobatic maneuvers, you'll know that the people up there are working really quite hard to keep these aircraft together. The team has retained the same personnel from the start. They're led by Ray Hanna, who has thousands of hours on warbirds of all types. Keith Skilling, who's also a highly skilled and highly experienced display pilot, alongside Lee Proudfoot. You saw him flying today. He flew the Spitfire in company with the Camel, which is at the moment, for me, the commentator's award for that little rundown there. And I hope the Spitfire is all over Europe. Totally appropriate that the part of the team is the inside information, but inevitably we've got the absolute
thank you. sir. It's more fun.
Jerry, I am going to have to take your hand and educate
you. Thank you. squad is assembled, Jerry.
Yeah, right, and I'm going to come down there in front of a firing squad, Graham.
Yes, Jerry.
All right,
off you go. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want to see Jerry Mead, the world's famous commentator.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, before I go, thank you very much. I've enjoyed myself. I won't be back next year because I'm about to face a firing squad. So thank you.
This is something that we've had to pay good money for. Graham, you've been working with Jerry for many a year. I bet this is a dream come true for you. Is not only seen him go to a firing squad, but seen a man of his age try and get over this fence with many assistants. So are you guys down there, you young lads in the hoodies, give him a hand over.
Yeah. Don't leave anything behind, Jerry.
Exactly.
Look.
Here we go. All to be acclaiming.
Firing squad! Take aim!
Jerry, say sorry!
Fire! Thank you, Jerry. I told you we would get you this year, and get you we have. Thank you.
Well done for the war horse. Remember, Joe. I can remember in 1987 I went to Australia to an air show there, a very nice centenary show, and one of the features was a Spitfire, and that was what I really enjoyed it for. So, I really wanted to. I wonder if any of you can draw an idea.
Jerry.
Yeah?
What do you expect the war horses to do when they like your style?
And they like mine?
Yeah. What's it really killing you?
So how long have you been sitting down there looking at them?
That's not up to you.
Alright, where are we? We're looking at this. Is really expensive. Come through for us in pairs one more time. Joe, this is your... your first time here at Wanaka.
Yes, indeed.
What did you think?
Wonderful scenery, wonderful airplanes, and the people have been nothing but gracious. One of the most friendly people that I've ever met in my whole life. I would like to extend a big thank you to the people of New Zealand for making us feel so very, very welcome.
Yes, I'd like to second that. So that's John Graff was here. We've got Ian Brody, Graham Cleary, Jim Hickey, all the commentary team. And also, we seem to have a dog up here on the bus sniffing around some of the bags. And what do we think this is?
Oh dear.
Joe, isn't that your bag down there somewhere?
Okay. Can I just say what a great
What's that, Joe? We've got about half a pound of C4 in Joe McGrath's bag. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, Mr. McGrath will be here a little longer than he originally thought. If you'd like to visit him.
Of you that are leaving right now, now is the best time to go and buy some special merchandise. Warbirds Over Wanaka merchandise, now is the time to buy it, and now is the time to buy it at a very good price. We have t-shirts now $15, the polo shirts are down to $30, we've got hats for $25, we've got wonderful Russian hats, just $55, thermo mugs. What's a thermo mug, Gavin? One that keeps stuff hot, I guess. $20 for the thermo mug. And a sack for $40. And I'm also reading here that it's a foldaway jacket. So we've got lots of bargains. T-shirts, $15. Polo shirts, $30. Hats for $25. And so it goes on. So go across to the Walden.